Thank you very much to Serco for the invitation, for this opportunity to talk about my third child at this biodiversity. I will have this presentation split in five parts. I will first introduce a little bit to the ASEAN Center for Biodiversity and to the background of the Convention for on Biological Diversity, as well as the Nagoya Protocol and the related agreements. In the second part, I will introduce a little bit on the economics, values of biodiversity and of ecosystems and of the services. In the third part, I will talk about the economist's word of biodiversity and ecosystems. And finally, two parts on degradation of ecosystem services in various countries. And finally, on the application of ecosystem services, of the evaluation and economics of ecosystem services in development planning. First, as you have heard, I'm based in the project of GIZ, German Corporation, in the ASEAN Center for Biodiversity. The ASEAN Center is an intergovernmental center for excellence, facilitating regional and global cooperation in conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity. It's an autonomous legal personality under the ASEAN Secretariat, and it's hosted by the government of the Philippines, and its offices are here in the forestry campus at UP. The ASEAN Center for Biodiversity is a regional hub for the implementation of the Convention for Biological Diversity, which is a child of the Rio 92 Earth Summit. 2 years ago, the President of the Philippines, Aquino, he declared, together with ACP and the head of the Convention of Biological Diversity, the decade of on biodiversity 2011 to 2020 for Southeast Asia. In the same year, there was the 10th Conference of Parties, as they are called, of the Convention for Biological Diversity in Nagoya. And at this conference, there were several important key decisions and results, of which probably the most important are the 20 IG targets, as they are called, on biodiversity, which form the basis for the activities and focuses of the decade of biodiversity. There were several strategic goals formulated under which the IG targets 1 to 20 are distributed. For our purpose here, for the biodiversity ecosystem services approach, for the evaluation of biodiversity, and for the economics of biodiversity, the most important ones are target 1, target 2, and target 14. Starting with target 1, it says by 2020, at the latest, people are aware of the values of biodiversity and the steps they can take to conserve and use it sustainably. And our project, the ASEAN Center for Biodiversity, and myself, by presenting this speech to you, we are striving towards this goal, which is still a few years ahead, but time is running very fast, and Earth is losing about 150 species through extinction forever per day. The target 2, by 2020 at the latest, biodiversity values have been integrated into national and local development and poverty reduction strategies and planning processes, and are being incorporated into national accounting as appropriate and reporting systems. It sounds very abstract, and I hope to contribute a little bit here to give a bit of a practical approach what it means. Biodiversity values have been integrated into national and global development and poverty reduction strategies and so on. Target 14 has to do with people. By 2020, ecosystems that provide essential services, including services related to water, and contribute to health, livelihoods, and well-being, these ecosystems are restored and safeguarded, taking into account the needs of women, indigenous and local communities, and the poor and vulnerable. So my presentation is trying to give some background to these three important IG targets, and as well as our entire project is doing. GIZ, most of you might have heard of the German Technical Corporation GIZ before, now it's renamed GIZ. GIZ is the development technical cooperation arm of German development. Our project is a module of a program that's being financed by the German government to support the ASEAN Center for Biodiversity. That's also the title of the program. Under this program, also other German donors contribute to the support to the ASEAN Center for Biodiversity, among others the Kreditanstalt für Wiederaufbau, EKFW Development Bank, and also our Ministry for the Environment, EMU, through the participation of ACB in a global approach on coastal marine resources management for blue solutions. You see, this is a very new logo that we are using for German cooperation. Our government has decided that all cooperation, whether it is through our Minister of Cooperation, through the Minister of Environment, through Ministry of Foreign Affairs, all have now the same logo, German cooperation. Our project, which is called Biodiversity and Climate Change Project, or MODU, has two pillars. It sounds a very simple structure: ecosystem management, biodiversity, and development. Under ecosystem management, we try to enhance the understanding of the interrelation between biodiversity and ecosystems. This is more a classical approach, has to do with protected areas, has to do with the effects of climate change, the effects on biodiversity, and also on protected ecosystems. The other pillar is the biodiversity and economy, which supports policies and actions for valuing biodiversity in the context of ecosystem services. In order to get somewhere closer, I'm already shifting to the second part of my presentation. The IG targets, as I have already presented to you, are the cornerstone of our component on biodiversity and economy. You might question, what is the value of biodiversity? Can I buy biodiversity? Can I sell it? And this is indeed a complex issue, and most, or if not all, of the assets of nature conservation are the good, are goods that are really not tradable, are not traded, and because they are not traded, they have no price tag on, and because they have no price tag, they are not perceived as valuable goods. So the fresh air and the clean water we take as gift, and many other things as well, the trees in the forest. And only if the tree has disappeared because of a storm or because of other environmental effects, goals, like possible goals. And the tree has also conserved the water in the soil, so we don't suffer from landslides and elevations. Usually we are not, but we don't want to pay. This drawing is a machine, a slot machine, where you can buy the system services. In our office we have 3 of these, inviting everybody to pay for ecosystem services, at least to get aware that there is a value behind that. Should I ask you, what are benefits of what biodiversity that would move value to us? Many, I have mentioned some of them, such as the other values of biodiversity that you will have in mind thinking about your environment.
Pollination.
Excellent, yes. I think that the guess is, I think, something like 3 billion US dollars per year.
Maybe more.
Or even more, yeah. And people say if the bees would fail to pollinate our crops, those crops that have to be pollinated by bees, we would have about 2 or 3 years and then we would fall into failure. This is a map of an area in China about 80 to 90% of their energy from hydropower. And since the 1980s, the hydropower plants pay the farmers to maintain the watershed of the hydropower dams in order to maintain the forest cover, because they realized that they would have to pay up to 10 times more to clean their reservoirs every 5 years or every 10 years when they are silted up, compared to what they have to pay to the farmers. One crucial thing about this for these farmers is, if the farmers don't have the land rights, so the hydropower plant has nobody to pay, because then it will be the government who will say, no, these are not established land owners. The hydropower plant rather has to pay the tax to the government, and then this immediate cooperation of the land users or of the resource users is being lost. And this is one of the big strengths of the Payment for Environment Services approach. This direct relationship between the one who uses an ecosystem service and the other one who is prone to maintain it, who has the capability and can accept some payments which allow him to reduce the intensity of land use. For example, not anymore banana, but agroforestry systems. At the same time, creating more diverse, more biodiverse, more agrobiodiverse systems in the watersheds. An excursion now to definitions. Ecosystems services are flows of value to human societies as a result of the status and the quality of natural capital. So the climate science or the biodiversity and economic science have determined different kinds of ecosystem services. One is called provisional service, for obvious reasons like wild food, crops, in the case of watershed services, fresh water, and land-derived materials. The second one is regulating services. For example, filtration of pollutants by wetlands, one function of ecosystem services can be that one. Climate regulation, already mentioned before, climate regulation through carbon storage, through water cycling, through pollination, and protection from disasters. Cultural services, for example, recreation, spiritual and aesthetic value, education. These cultural services is a typical service provided in the framework of ecotourism. Finally, supporting services, for example, the soil formation, photosynthesis, nutrient cycling, that are also not easily recognized as services by ecosystems or by biodiversity assets. That's me. And the guy is me. This is only 1.5 years now, or otherwise it would be too heavy. This was a visit in Wollongong. As you mentioned before, I was project director of Panda Project in Sichuan for a couple of years. One of my privileges was to know this guy. Unfortunately, the Wollongong station was largely destroyed by the big earthquake in Sichuan. It was only reopened again last year. Several of the pandas were lost, and also several casualties and stuff. But ecotourism is oriented at several ecosystem services, particularly those I mentioned already related to cultural services. Besides being a vehicle for creating awareness and funding for ecosystem conservation and management. Still in many countries, ecosystem services through ecotourism are the most common and the most effective way of generating money historic forms of ecotourism to you now?
To
value existing services, we have to classify, we have to determine methodologies of valuing, whether it is something that is trade, or whether it is a price that is determined by an alternative product. Instead of wood, you could use aluminium for certain things, or you could use, if it's firewood, you could use coal. So you compare the prices and you determine what is the value of this piece of wood, for example. This is the case again of this hydropower development effect. Provisional services, water supply. That is, are the benefits through this hydropower system that we have presented before. Municipal water supply. This is so-called shadow price and irrigation benefits as well. If you ask me for a very proper definition of shadow prices, I would say ask an economist. There are very good economists in this house here for good research. But then they can tell you, you know the value of biodiversity, I have the methodology to assess it. So it's us, we have to tell them what the value is. They might determine, yes, for this one the best method is the shadow price method. Provisional services, agriculture, forestry, obvious, there's a market. They take the market, then the method. Provision services, shipping industry, shipping benefits, and the market value. And also for the hydropower generation, the market value for electricity. Valuation methods, the regulating service. Now it becomes again a little bit tangible, intangible. Flood regulation benefits, or shadow price method, water flow breakup through regulating through the reduction of the speed the water goes from the mountain down to the valley. Again, the shadow price approach. Regulating services, river transport, reservoir sedimentation, project restoration method. That means how much has to be paid to compensate the damages done. Land formation by sedimentation, opportunity cost approach. That is an alternative to the lake. It's, when the lake is silted up, we have agriculture land. This also has a bad regulating service. Soil conservation, soil erosion, again, the price to restore. And also the geological hazard in the same story. Regulating service, environmental decontamination. That is also an environment service. So, as we know, we have a park in the village or in the town, and when the wind blows from this side, the air is better on that side. Because nature, forest, the green land is filtering the air. This was the regulation of local microclimate. Again, the shadow price methods. Cultural services, aesthetic value, tourism. They call it the travel cost method. This is some kind of also pricing method. Education and scientific research is again our shadow price. You see, many of our values are shadow prices. We have to really to be inventive to put their price tag, what it will use, what the value is. Supporting services, primary production. Organic matter production, that is for example in forestry or grasslands, CO2 sequestration and the oxygen release. Again, the market values. As you know, in the framework of the climate change discussion, in many countries we have now an established market for carbon, and like in the case of Germany, we are reinvesting all the proceeds from the carbon market, from the so-called voluntary carbon market. We reinvest in conservation and in reforestation projects. cycle and the habitat, biodiversity, a contingent valuation method. Again, something which needs to be specified. How much is an ecosystem worth? How much is it worth that tigers and elephants and lions live in an ecosystem? Question and answer. Are the effects positive or negative related to the ecosystem services? There are some. River transport contributes rather to reservoir sedimentation. You need the water, you have better river transport, but it's silting up because the lake is there and it has siltation. So, in principle, if it is in the interest of the shipping industry to have the lake, they would have to pay if the lake is maintained clean and proper. And they themselves contribute to the deterioration for the environment service. This is a map of Indonesia. It's just by chance I found that this map. I could also take a map from the sea, from the Bokoro Basin, from Amazon. Deforestation and habitat loss are rampant, leading to widespread ecosystem degradation. That's a qualitative aspect of it. And devaluation of the ecosystems. It leads to impoverishment of the rural societies because they are lacking the necessary resources for a decent profitable land use. Loss of biodiversity. I mentioned this 100 species. This is a rough guess per day that are lost. And many of them, even before anybody has known the species. Nothing can be done about it. Nothing. Another matter, possibly. Just to look at between the 1980s, 1940s, and in the 1980s, there were the world's worst country for deforestation. They got rid of their forest in a very efficient way. And then came a time in the 1980s where the government has completely revised its policy. They had institutes like the famous INBIO, predecessor of the access and benefit sharing, of making use of natural resources for the medicinal research and development. And they had many visitors. It's a very safe country. Many visitors from the United States, and visitors started to appreciate ecotourism, started to appreciate an intact nature. And times come, they start their watershed, payment for watershed services, as I mentioned, hydropower. They started to develop ecotourism, and they learned that this is generating value, generating income, national income. And they maintain, they have one of the first to generate a fuel tax. And the proceeds from the tax went into payment for environment services in the countryside. And as you see, less forest every year. But then they start again. They're coming back, the forest is coming back. I didn't find a more recent map, but they are the world leaders in ecotourism. They are the world leaders in payment for environment services. They have a ministry which is called Pago de Servicios Ambientales, and they really have shown that it's possible. It's possible to revert the tendency to get rid of nature and of biodiversity and ecosystem assets. Why are the rural poor so much affected by the degradation of land and resources? This picture from Bhopal last year from the cyclone. cycle is not an event that can easily be avoided, but still, you see, the world poor, they need an integrated ecosystem for housing, for transport, for cropping, for energy supply, for their safety and for their survival. And if you consider that the ecosystem services are much more important for the world poor than for the average of the society, then we will have an access or an understanding of the following. The first line is the classical GDP, where the green sector, forestry, agriculture, is a rather small sector, 10%, 17%, and 6% in the case of Brazil. But if you take the ecosystem services as percentage of importance to the rural poor, then you can come to a different picture. And then you realize how important the ecosystem services are for the rural poor. And then rethink again the national development. Why are the rural poor going to the towns? Because they have easier access to the non-green sector income. Why do they have to leave the countryside? Because their rural environment is degrading, is being devalued through whatever kind of unsustainable activities by the farmers themselves, by other sectors, like mining, name it, like by big industrial plantations that are providers of income. It's a blue sector. So, I'm slowly coming to a conclusion. Biodiversity is more than species preservation. Most of you know that biodiversity assets provide services and goods that form part of local and regional development. The integration of biodiversity and ecosystem services into development planning is a challenging, but it's a necessary step forward. There's a need for new partnerships, for governance and an orientation towards green economies, to get this discrepancy between classical economies and the green sector economy, ecosystem-based economies, in balance. In the framework of the discussion about the economics of ecosystems and biodiversity, there's now an approach being developed that is called integrating ecosystem services into development plan. So we don't do development planning only comparing cost benefits, investment return and proceeds from investments and so on. But we make the ecosystem services an integral part of development. And not only rural development, they're more and more also considering green cities or green cities. Green city development as a valuable approach to improve life in towns and health in urban and metropolitan areas. I don't need to tell you how privileged we are here outside, compared to the capital. Biodiversity is the basis of functioning ecosystems. Development is linked to the availability of ecosystem services, and development and economic activities can have negative impacts on ecosystems. So this needs to be balanced planning implementation. Now, how can we and can our partners reduce the dependence of ecosystem services? How can we reduce negative impacts on ecosystems? And how can we enhance the quality and quantity of ecosystem services provided by our environment? Which risks do we have to avoid? What are the opportunities? And what are the distribution costs? Because the ecosystem might be on one place, but it is on a different place. The integrating ecosystem services approach is a systematic step-wise approach to systematically evaluate and value ecosystem services and to integrate them in development processes. The objective is not only to visualize what is going on, but to clarify risks and opportunities, identify and assess alternatives, development alternatives, away from unsustainable use of natural assets towards a sustainable utilization. The IDS pursues a six-step approach, which I criticize because it's all planning and only the last one is implementation. Defining surface scopes, screening and prioritizing, identifying conditions and trends, appraising institutional and cultural frameworks, preparing better decision making, and finally implementing change. The guiding principles are recognizing the value of ecosystem services, describe them, and integrate them in development. So this is the appeal: reverse the common sense of exploitation and environment of our environment, and come into responsible and sustainable models of extraction and resource utilization, not letting him get away with the last three without him playing 10 new ones. Live in harmony. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Seibert. The floor is now open for our audience to address your comments and questions to our speaker. Please use the microphones around the room and kindly introduce yourself and the organization you're affiliated with. Any questions from the audience?
Then Yeah, it's a privileged situation. And on the other hand, I mean, the bigger countries, I mean, the example of Brazil. Brazil has areas where they generate a lot of income. They have industrialized areas and they have the Amazon area. I think they would still quite bad in the Amazon, but they would have the potential and the economic power in the nation, in one nation. If you go to ASEAN, it might be different. And if you look into the ASEAN roadmap, there are all kind of statements of regional cooperation in order to achieve this and that. And we have rich countries like Brunei, Singapore. We have poor countries like Cambodia and Myanmar. And only in a concerted action, in an upgraded evaluation of the importance of biodiversity, of livelihood in a more general way, the societies can move towards more sustainable development, more green development, I would say. It's not easy to achieve. I mean, we see every year, we see the problems in the conferences of parties, be it climate change, be it biodiversity. It is very difficult on a global level to achieve these targets, these hygiene targets. They are very ambitious. And frankly, I mean, in Nagoya, they decided was the target to reduce biodiversity loss was not achieved. And not only not achieved in bad countries, in all countries, they haven't achieved it. It is not high on the political agenda. And our next and next generations will have to pay for it. They pay for our sins. And when we pay for it, and when we talk about ecosystem services and payment for ecosystem services, it is a day to day. But we also have to suffer from the disadvantages of the past. I remember 30 years ago, rattan products were very, very famous in Europe, very cheap. Sold out cheap. There's no rattan anymore in Philippines. I haven't seen any new rattan chair in the Philippines. There might be somewhere. This is a huge deprivation. Society pays for this. They pay that they have exported for a cheap price an asset and a product that is not sustainably used. So things can be done on a national level. I agree that globalization cannot be avoided. But let's say we have to consider that the countries live off trade and of interchange. That starts more. On the own community, on the own countryside, better the land use, reduce the need for you to move around every day to, I don't know. I'm lucky in the position to have 3 minutes to my workplace. I don't know what I would do if I would have to go to Manila every day. I'm privileged. I wouldn't have accepted a job in Manila. And I like living out here. The village I lived before was even smaller than most families. It was only two houses.
A lot of incentive mechanism for people to encourage encourage people to get from ecotourism and similar activities. That's all. Thank you.
We have room for one more question. Anyone from the audience? Yes, please.
Thank you for your very nice presentation and informative information about your project. I just happened to pass here. I don't know there's a seminar like this. I'm from the College of Forestry and Natural Resources in this university. My question about your topic is, you're talking about the evaluation of ecosystem services, and you have listed down some of the services provided by ecosystems, and there are concerns in the literature about overlapping of these services, and there is also a concern or a debate in the literature about how to standardize this valuation, wherein we can avoid the overlapping of values. Like for example, in the economy, we value the value of that car itself, not the metals and the screw, the pieces of components to make that car. But in the ecosystem services, there are valuation that values the intermediaries, not the final product. So I am interested if your project is doing that role, and I would like to know how it would be done. And the other concern that I am looking also is there's this concern about PAS versus PED. Like example, in Malaysia, there are companies that claiming for providing environmental service, but at the same time they are degrading the environment. So are they be allowed to pay, or they be asked to pay the damage, or they just be paid of their services? For example, they are claiming about carbon sequestration, but at the same time they are eroding because they are changing the land use. That's my concern. Thank you.
Yeah, you pose very different questions. Particularly the one with the evaluation of complex systems. As I said, as it was mentioned, I'm a forester biologist. I joined a conference on this economics of ecosystem and biodiversity last year in Germany. And I must admit, I thought I was quite lost, because they're all economists around. But I'm sure they're also lost, because there's a missing nexus between these two. And maybe the most important result of these methodologies is that we come closer to talk to each other, to understand what is society as an economy, as a product, as a market, as a trade, and everything. Biodiversity is a very complex and difficult to understand subject in terms of our human brain, economists and lawyers and administrators. So this is very odd, they have not, but we have to learn. And if you go to the countryside, you find very simple farmers or hunters or fishermen. They know better. They know better about the system. We are able. When we have wonderful words of economy and returns and cost and benefit and everything, but sometimes you find somebody who tells you, yeah. As simple as that. You take the fish, you sell it, and you might make sure that you do not catch the female fish, because this is important for your production. Some things are very, very simple, and it is our task and our challenge. And we are right still at the beginning to understand these systems and to create new forms of scientific and development communication on these subjects. The integrated companies. Yeah, it's a question of governance, of control, of taxation, of incentives. One of the IG targets is with the abolition of perverse incentives, as they call it. No, I mean, our government is paying subsidies for renewable energy. The consequence that Borneo is reforested with palms, providing manpower, providing jobs and everything, that's fine. But this is simplifying ecosystem services to a really marginal level. I mean, even the secondary forest is much more biodiverse than the palm production, the palm plantation. And being frank to you, mankind, we are too many. We need food. And we have more and more difficulties to produce our food in such a way that it is not harmful to the next generation. And I mean, in some way, we in this sector, we are committed to find ways out, and I tell you, it is not easy. Because you also need the politicians, you need the politicians to think on the framework of 4 years or 5 years, because otherwise they wouldn't be there. We have to admit, they have to think that. That's how our society was created.